careful, got through it all. I know you'll be by my side. There's no guarantee in this life. Your trouble's a matter of time, but you're in control. That's how I know. Faith has growing pains. Sometimes faith has growing pains. Sometimes faith has growing pains. There's no game without the pain. Sometimes faith has growing pains. Everything gon' be okay. One of us won't be afraid.
Don't be afraid.
Sometimes faith has growing pains.
WCF family, what's going on? My name is Mitch.
I'm Jarrett.
And welcome to church today. We got some announcements for you guys. First announcement, this Wednesday night worship service is canceled.
Canceled.
So don't show up this Wednesday. Spend some time with your family. Have some fun. Also, though, because it's canceled, we're doing a special night of worship April 5th at 7 p.m. till like 8:30. It's going to be SEU worship. We have a couple special guests, Jacob Lynch and Austin Shuffett from SEU Worship. So come join us. It'll be a fun time in the main sanctuary, April 5th, 7 p.m.
All right. It's our next announcement. We have, guess what? It's Easter time.
Yeah, come on.
So we got Good Friday service this Friday starting at 10. It's only till 11. Make sure you come out. It'll be a good time. Palm Sunday today, hey?
Oh, yeah.
Just so you know.
Yeah, dude. Yeah,
bring it up. And then we also got on Sunday, we got Easter service, which is called The Lion. That'll be, we got both services, 9-11.
So come join us Easter weekend. Exciting things happening. Also, baptism is happening on Easter Sunday, the 31st. So come join us if you want to get baptized. You know someone that wants to get baptized, 9 a.m. Be here for service on the 31st, and you have the opportunity.
Nice. Last, two more announcements. We have the last day to find Jesus.
Find Jesus.
I'm not.
Have
I'm
you
not
found saying, Jesus?
Oh, a couple times.
A couple times.
In, hold on. Are we talking like the little guys or like?
Oh, maybe both.
Oh, okay.
All right.
But this is the last week to find Jesus. Make sure that you, if you do find him, you go to the foyer.
Yeah, the Children's Church foyer. Children's find Graceland. Graceland will be there in the Children's Church foyer. And she will take your photo and ask you maybe a question about where you actually met Jesus, not just a little Jesus.
Where did you meet Jesus?
Dude, I met Jesus when I was like 5 years old. And just like, I remember like being at home and just being like, all right, God, I'm giving my life to you. And just, it was it, ever since then.
Solid, man.
It's been a journey.
Good. Well,
yeah.
Good journey so far.
Good journey so far.
Good journey
still
so
here.
Far.
Last thing is stay connected. Stay connected to what's happening, what's going on. Maybe you missed everything me and Jared just said. That's okay. We still love you.
100% you missed what I said.
Yeah.
I'm used to it. It's good.
We love our guests on here. But come, hey, check out what's happening. Go to our newsletter. Sign up. Just go to WCF.ca. Scroll down. Put in your email. Click subscribe and find out what's happening. We hope we want you guys to get connected.
The other part is we do have Instagram, Facebook, and all those other social medias. Yeah. We also got YouTube. If you would like to hear the message again, make sure you go to the YouTube channel, hit subscribe, and it comes up real quick.
Yeah. Lots of opportunities. Don't miss out. But we're going to jump into worship. So, worship team, take it away.
I got to be late.
Well, good morning, church. Who's excited to be here this morning? Who's ready to worship? Well, God, we just thank you for your presence this morning. Come into your throne room, expected to come boldly. God, we just thank you for who you are and what you're doing. We lift you up this morning because you are holy. We behold you this morning, Father.
Songs forever to the Lamb. and positions, your name stands above them all.
Come on, church, let's sing that out.
Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name.
Final word.
God, this morning we turn our eyes to you. We fix our eyes on you this morning. Especially in this season, God, where we look at what you did on the cross for our sin. God, we thank you that your presence is tangible. We thank you that you are hope and life.
My heaven. everything, I pour my oil on you. I pour my oil on you. Take all I have, it's all yours anyways. I know it's not much, but God, it's my everything. I pour my oil on you. I pour my oil on you. Doesn't matter the cost, 'cause Jesus, you're worthy of every last drop. Here is my offering. I pour my oil on you. I pour my oil on you. Take all I have, it's all yours anyways. I know it's not much, but God, it's my everything. I pour my oil on you. I pour my oil.
You deserve all my praise. heavens wept for you.
To the King. Jesus, we are so thankful, Father, that you thought of us. When you died on that cross, you did it for us. You didn't have to. But your love is so deep, God. It's tangible today, God. Father, let love break the chains of fear over hearts today, God. Over shame, guilt, condemnation. Looking in the past, Father God, you are the God of moving forward, keeping our eyes on the prize, pressing forward, God. We thank you, Father God, that you've washed away sin. That's what you did on the cross, not what we did, what you did. Let your love fall, God.
Good morning, WCF family. My name is Vanessa, and this is my wonderful husband, Peter.
Good morning.
And this morning, we will be reading Genesis 9, 1 through 7. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens, upon everything that creeps on the ground and all the fish of the sea. Into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And as I gave you the green plants, I give you everything. But you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, its blood."
And for your lifeblood, I will require reckoning. From every beast I will require it, and from man. From his fellow man I will require reckoning for the life of man. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed, for God made him in his own image. And you, be fruitful and multiply, increase greatly on the earth and multiply in it.
Have a wonderful Sunday.
Bye, guys.
Amen. Good morning, church family. Good to see you guys today. My name is Pastor Mitch.
My name is Tim.
And we are privileged to see all of your beautiful faces here this morning. We want to let you guys know that kids, you guys are dismissed, and junior youth, but grade eights, please remain in service. So if you're in grade eight, stay in service.
All right, it is time for the tithes and the offering.
Come on. Woo!
So, early this week, while I was praying to God, asking him, "Lord, what should I speak upon for this Sunday? What do you want me to say? What are your words for me?" And the one song, Gyra, by Maverick City Music, it just came to mind. And so there's these lyrics, and it says, "If he dresses the lilies with beauty and splendor, how much more will he clothe you?" And so, that just really had me reflect on God loves us so much. He loves us so much more than the birds, the lilies, the flowers. And if he made us before, in our mother's womb, before we've been born, if he designed us, if he had a plan for us, if he loves us so much that he only wants good things for us, then we can trust in him that he'll provide for us. We can trust that we can give him our tithes, our offering, that he will work it for his good, that he will make sure that we will have enough, we will have surplus. So, I pray that this morning as we give, we reflect upon how generous God has been to us and how much he will just continue to provide for us throughout our lives. So, if you could join me for prayer, that'd be great. Lord God, thank you for just continually providing for us throughout our entire lives, just for giving us enough, Lord God, for ensuring, Lord God, that we can just continue to praise your name, continue to bring your message, Lord God, to people who haven't heard it yet. And I pray that as we collect the tithes and offerings today, that Lord God, you take it, Lord Jesus, you use it, Lord God, just to grow your kingdom, just to bring it on earth, Lord God, so that, Lord God, people who haven't found you, that they can find you, Lord God, so that we can redeem people, Lord God, back to you. And I pray that, Lord Jesus, we are cheerful, generous givers, Lord God, that you help us, Lord God, to give expecting you to move, that we give, Lord God, knowing that you will do so much more with what we can give you than what we could do with it on our own, Lord God. So I pray that, Lord God, we give faithfully and that you continue to be faithful to us. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. And also, there are a couple ways that you can give. We have e-transfer, the WCF app. The ushers also have envelopes. And you can also give at the Welcome Center after service.
Amen. Well, we are in a series called The Days of Noah. And who's enjoying it so far? Yeah, you received from it. Amazing series so far. We had a couple messages so far, so if you haven't seen them, please go back to our YouTube channel and watch them. Last one was on Satan's agenda on the earth, which is a really good one from Pastor RJ and Pastor Larry. But today, we have a special guest, Melissa, joining Pastor RJ and Pastor Larry. So can you welcome them up at this time?
Good morning, everyone. How are you all doing today? All is well and good?
Yeah.
Well, we are in for a treat today. We have a really good conversation for you. I think. No, I know. I was just thinking because I couldn't get my notes open. So, last time we were together, we talked about Satan's agenda in the earth, how he wants to destroy humans, the image bearers, who are made in the image and likeness of God. Over the next few weeks, we're going to roll out some of the ways that he operates to attack humans. And today, as we talk about, as we've called it, Frankenfood, we're hoping that through the conversation, you're going to see and realize a little bit more about how Satan's trying to operate to keep you from optimum health. And that said, I'm just mixing this up a little bit. We're going to introduce Melissa in 1 second. But how many of you want to feel awake? Alive? How many of you, I don't know, you are active and fit? How many of you are clear-minded and focused, laser-focused? How many of you are energized that you can do anything that God has called you to do and complete the assignment on your life?
Okay.
Well, Melissa, why don't you tell them a little bit about who you are?
And with that, so it's not ironic. I was going to say ironically, but nothing is an accident. And God is so good. And takes all of us on a journey to equip us to what his purpose is for us. And my post-secondary education began in PR and marketing. And not ironically, what we want to expose and enlighten you guys with is how PR and marketing sells us what we eat in our food. And so, from PR and marketing, I worked in the fashion industry overseas in China and lived there for almost 3 years and was very effectively skinny fat. I drank Diet Coke for breakfast and I looked the part and I felt zero energy. And so fast forward, I moved back to Toronto. I worked in the advertising industry for a bit, which is horrific if anyone works in that industry. But then I just transitioned into the fitness industry and I went back to school and I started coaching in a fitness sense as well, went to culinary school and got into bodybuilding. So I actually was a pro bodybuilder in the figure category. So I learned how to carve and mold the outside and I was fit and strong. And also this aha of health comes from the inside out. So I went back to school again and got my holistic nutrition registration and really suitcased all that together to be really a health curator. And so to understand that our health does come from the inside out and that health is our greatest wealth and that without our health, none of us can optimize our God-given purpose on the earth. So our intention of this conversation is just to enlighten an area for each one of you that we can just do better.
Excellent, thank you. So how many know as Peter and Vanessa, who I think are watching us from Verona, Italy right now, good morning, guys. As they read earlier, God set up seed time and harvest.
Yeah.
Okay. Pastor Larry, why don't you share a little bit of your background?
So I am a farm boy. Grew up on a farm, grain mostly, but chickens as well. And then later on, I married a farm girl who's sitting right over there. But you know, my experience growing up is I grew up in a family, a large family, and so my mom was very frugal in providing for the family. So we had large gardens, and interestingly, whatever was planted and harvested, the seeds were kept for the next year to grow again. And I never remember ever my mom ever going to buy seeds from the grocery store or from wherever. In the same sense, my dad, as a grain farmer, would always keep some of the grain from the harvest for the next year. But as time progressed, growing up, all of a sudden, you know, some of the marketing was changed and whatnot. And I didn't understand exactly what it was, but some of our neighbors, they began going to a more cultural production process where they were promised better production, more a greater harvest, yield harvest, but also strains of grain that were more not as sensitive to chemicals and different things like that, so that they could spray stronger chemicals on the crops and kill the weeds so that you have a cleaner crop. But anyways, my dad never went that way. Always tried very hard to stay natural as much as possible, keeping his own seed. And I know from, you know, in the area where I grew up, some of the other farmers tried to do that as well. Some of them, as a result, because the market was going to GMO crops, all of a sudden facing lawsuits from some of the chemical companies and the grain companies, because when you grow a GMO crop, you're not ownership of that crop at all, at any point. And so there was lawsuits against cross-pollination and things like this, which was a mess. But marrying Colleen and learning, you know, about her dad, who was also very much of a health buff and wanting to, you know, just even with cattle, because he had a lot of cattle, very, very particular about how he grew crops to keep them natural, didn't use chemicals, did different seeding processes in order to minimize any of the influx of chemical and whatnot into the grains, and try to keep it as much natural as possible. Also, you know, keeping seed back for the next year and so on. So that's a bit of it.
Thank you. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 23, you say I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is good for you. You say I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is beneficial. Our hope is that through today's conversation, you can eat anything, but not everything will be beneficial for you. And we're going to focus in a little bit later. We'll talk about this more, but it's what God has created is good. And some of the things that man is creating right now are not necessarily beneficial for your body, which leads us to, let's start with optimizing health.
So we've heard the term, you are what you eat. No, you are what you eat. We're actually what we absorb. So the concept, you are what you eat, has to extend into what you're absorbing from what you're eating. So when you have a crop that is laden with pesticides designed to kill a bug from the inside out in their gut, you have to wonder what it's doing to your gut. When you eat a genetically engineered food to grow into the most beautiful, and we said this is kind of, it's not ironic, because it's not ironic, it's completely an apple used in the garden of evil as temptation. Do you know what the most chemically drenched fruit is?
Apples.
It's an apple. What? There are so many things when I was like preparing for, I'm a complete geek in this. So as I was preparing for this, I was like, oh my goodness, that's crazy. But so you have to think of what you're absorbing from that genetically engineered product, because there are some products that have been removed so far from the God-made organic version of the original that it's no longer food or nourishment to our bodies. So when you have this, what looks like perfect on the outside, but is nutrient void on the inside, our bodies can't assimilate any nutrients from that. So we're starving, and we live in a generation where we are overfed and undernourished in so many ways, but we'll keep it to food today. But you have to understand that we are God's masterpiece. And he has made our body in such a way that when you get a craving, it means you're lacking a nutrient in your body. What, after first service, someone came up to me in the front and said, this craving for chocolate. I was like, well, that's actually an indication you're low in magnesium. She said, oh, that's so interesting. I just started adding some magnesium. But when you take the time to investigate the check engine light that's going off in a symptom in your body, that's God telling you something is not right. But we live in a time where we take a Tylenol for a headache instead of addressing the disease that's causing that headache. So to optimize our health, you have to think, what am I absorbing from this food I'm about to eat?
You know, there's something that you said that that caught my attention, actually the first service, and we were moving on, so I never said it. But regarding the apple, I remembered something that my dad always said, if the worms don't like it, it's probably not good for you.
So good. So good.
Yeah.
Why don't you talk about Daniel 1?
Okay. Daniel 1, the first 14 verses. No, we're just reading 14 to 16. But the story about Daniel, where Daniel and his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're brought over in captivity, and they're offered, because of their wisdom and whatnot, they're being groomed to be in the king's service. And there, they were offered the best food of the kingdom. But they requested, can we just eat vegetables and water? And upon agreement from the supervisor over them, this was the end result, starting at verse 15, where it says, at the end of the 10 days, Daniel and his three friends looked healthier and better nourished than the young men who had been eating the food assigned by the king. So after that, the attendant fed them only vegetables instead of the food and wine provided for the others. And, you know, it's just a story of understanding that, you know, the norm isn't always the best, right? What everybody else is saying, oh, no, that's just normal, that may not be the best for you.
Okay. This is so true. So, hey, what's the world's number one most played board game?
Monopoly.
She didn't give you a chance. You're right, but you didn't give them a chance.
No, I heard them. They were
okay.
I'm just listening.
It's like, let them play.
No, they were, yeah. Okay. Like, there's a few people right here in this area here. It's okay. Because I'm sitting on this side.
Anyway, why don't we talk about the Monopoly right now that we're seeing in the world that we live in? Just briefly.
Just briefly, because you did not sign up for the four-hour version of this. So briefly, what was so fascinating is, so how do you win the game of Monopoly? What is the objective, like, right?
Take everybody's money.
Well, to take everyone. But basically, to collect all of the valuable real estate.
Yep.
And then charge a tax when anyone lands on your spot. And once you own the majority, you can build equity in more hotels, homes, etc. Real estate.
Yep.
So what was interesting in looking at the topic we're discussing today is that the Health Canada and FDA, does anyone know what FDA stands for? It's Food and Drug Administration. So they're the banker of today's topic. And so big food and big pharma have the same business plan. it blew my mind, right? So looking into, they play by the same rules and they align with each other. When you were talking about the GMO seeds, so GMO seeds work with the biochemical company. Monsanto owns the two largest. So they're a tag team. So build a seed, douse it with poison. Oh, wait, then that seed, because originally was from God, adapted. So pour more poison. So that's the point where you have to go, okay, what am I absorbing from this seed? But in a monopoly sense, you have to look at, in Canada, the government does not require us to know whether a food has been genetically modified, which blows my mind because they do require the farmers and the companies who choose with integrity to provide organics, God-made organics, they require them to spend lots of money to prove that they haven't altered his work. So some farmers won't go through the cost because they can't to get that sticker that says organic. Wait a minute. But the person who's genetically engineered with the help of big pharma and lots of money, they don't have to tell us what they've put in theirs, and they can patent protect their product for 30 years without us knowing the health ramifications of their product. So you have to question, where are you willing to spend your grocery dollars? Because if we look at monopolies, and if we go to the next slide, just briefly looking at, like, let's put some dollars and cents to this. So when you look at big pharma, this is from 2023. Pfizer alone made $994.80 US, so that's about, we said, 2,500 Canadian.
Not going.
Per second of every hour and every day in 2023. And the rest of them fill in. I mean, I if you go all the way to the other side, I would not be upset making $130 US every second, and they're like at the bottom. So when you go to the next slide, you have to look at the blueprint of grocery stores. So they're like the dealers of our food, right? That's where we go to our food resources. And thinking of the game of Monopoly, in 1986, these were the options we had to go buy food. Fast forward to the next slide, which was 2023, we've got five. Three of which are Canadian, two of which are from the States. So Loblaws, Sobeys, and Metro, they own, if you go to the next slide, the options, next slide, the options of where you shop. So if you didn't know, you'd think we have a lot of choices. But we have three choices. And so they are only the dealers of the choices given to them in products and produce, which are produced by the company making $1,000 US per second. So the encouraging, I don't say this to scare you, I say this to encourage you that these establishments, it's supply and demand. If we demand better, you will get better. If you refuse to buy Frankenfood with your dollar under the guise that it's cheaper, health is your greatest wealth. And if you can't assimilate the nutrients in a genetically engineered, ultra-processed box of food that never expires, then you're causing inflammation in your body. And think of that as a filter between you and God. Because that's how the enemy gets us. When you have a headache, are you going to go to your prayer closet? When your body is inflamed and aching, are you able to fulfill your purpose? The enemy has won.
Can I just talk about the headache thing a little bit?
Yeah, let me read this first.
Okay, yep.
In 1 Timothy 4, 1-5, and then Pastor Larry will share. Now the Holy Spirit tells us clearly that in the last time, some will turn away from the true faith. They will follow deceptive spirits and teachings that come from demons. These people are hypocrites and liars, and their consciences are dead. They will say it is wrong to be married and wrong to eat certain foods. But God created these foods to be eaten with thanks by faithful people who know the truth. Contextually, since everything God created is good.
Yeah.
Can everyone say that with me? Since everything God created is good, we should not reject any of it, but receive it with thanks. That's where we get receiving your food with thanksgiving. For we know it's made acceptable by the word of God in prayer. The things that God made for you are good. The things that man are making for you are not necessarily good.
That's true.
This is what we're trying to communicate to you about the Frankenfood. Okay, go ahead, share your.
So, like I said, I grew up on a farm, always eating natural food, milk straight from a cow, all the good stuff. And when I went to Bible college and seminary, all of a sudden, I'm eating processed foods, and in my first year, I started noticing a gradual increase in headaches, migraine headaches, and I didn't understand what was going on. In my second year, they got so bad that I spent more time in the infirmary than I did in class, and so it got to the point where my headaches were so terrible that even painkillers and like the injection to get me to sleep wouldn't put me to sleep because I was in so much pain. And so I got to a place, I called my counselor to come into the infirmary, and I says, please, can you just put me on a bus and send me home? And after discussion, they put me on a bus, they sent me home, and it took 4 months before I could actually exist in society, apart from having that constant headache, of, again, eating natural foods. And it was in that process that I came to a place of realizing, you know, the impact of food on my body.
Absolutely. Our body gives us check engine lights. A headache is a check engine light. And so we don't go from healthy to diseased overnight. So be encouraged that you are what you repeatedly do. Yep. And our God is so good that our body, think of how resilient we are to live in the environment with the lack of sleep, not enough water, overwork, commute, pollution, all, and we're still alive.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. But 2.0 is to thrive. Because if we aren't able to optimize our health, then we're alive but not thriving. So there's a physician, Dr. Peter Attia. He's a Canadian, now practices in Texas. And his book, Longevity, is brilliant if you want to dive deeper into what he identifies as the four horsemen. And that is the four slow death diseases that take out most humans. So heart disease, type 2 diabetes, cancer, and neurological diseases, i.e. Alzheimer's, dementia. That's how most people die. And it's encouraging because we don't have to activate that exit. But when we fuel our body with non-food substances, our body can't nourish itself to heal and thrive. So unfortunately, and this was his aha moment, was that he realized as an oncologist that by the time his patient got to his operating table, it was too late. He then went into, as a physician, said that his education, and I have several clients who are also physicians, which was fascinating to talk to them about this, was that they get 0 days of education in nutrition as a doctor. Zero. And that makes them very, very, very qualified to if you get your leg cut off, they'll sew you up. If you have acute issues, absolutely, like we need our medical system, but you have to understand what expertise someone has and what experience someone has. So he was saying that you have to take accountability for the actions that you do every day to prevent getting on his table with cancer, which I thought was so inspiring to say, like, he knows what he knows, but he knows what he doesn't know. So go to someone who knows about that, which we hope today will help you with.
Right. So when we go to, we're talking about GMOs a little bit, genetically modified organisms, and since they've come on the scene, food allergies have gone up over 400%.
Yes, true.
Okay. But when you're trying to avoid these, what would be some things that we maybe could eat?
Oh, me. So in the sense of, because there's, the thing is that, again, we have this conversation not to scare you or overwhelm you, but go like, what's your best return on investment? I always think of, if I'm going to put effort in, what's my best return on investment? And so when you're talking in the sense of organics, I always encourage my clients to buy organic meat. And that's because if you eat, say, a conventional cow, like a conventionally grown cow, they have grown up on GMO corn feed, which they're not meant to eat. They're meant to farm on grass. And so it changes their biochemistry in many ways, because they also get potentially hormones and antibiotics enough to satisfy a cow. So they're a bit larger than a human. So if you are what you eat and what you absorb from what you're eating, you're absorbing the GMO feed as well as the hormones, growth hormones, as well as the antibiotics, which correlates directly to insulin resistance as well as like obesity, because a growth hormone makes you grow.
And cows were designed to eat grass.
Cows are designed to eat grass, which is what gives them the composition of healthy fat ratios. So omega-3 versus omega-6 fatty acids, right? When you talk about good fats, bad fats, omega-3 will never cause inflammation in our human body. You often get that from fish, okay? But you also get it from a cow who's eaten grass. Omega-6 has a tipping point that once you eat too much, it will cause inflammation. So inflammation is the starter check engine light to all disease. God programmed us that way. Dis-ease. Something's wrong. Disease. Inflammation. Oh, let's ignore it. Let's take a Tylenol. Let's take a Tums. It's okay. An anti-inflammatory. Instead of looking at what are you repeatedly doing? If you are repeatedly eating inflammatory foods, creating that filter between you and God, the enemy's winning. So I would say that would be your first, is your meats that you eat. And then second, you could Google Dirty Dozen Clean 15. And they'll give you a list of most toxic sprayed crops would be the Dirty Dozen. So that would be maybe your next entrance point of going, you know what, I'm going to buy organic or the GMO, non-GMO. So the FDA has also required any produce grower or product that says, if you see that little sticker that says non-GMO, they make them pay to get that. So support that. Because the other ones, you can assume almost that it is GMO at this point.
So right there, I hear people say all the time, oh, well, it costs so much more to buy this type of meat or to buy this type of produce. However, I think you were, I don't know if you did it in this particular conversation yet, but it has to do with what you absorb in nutrient density. So one thing that I heard you say was people will eat a lot of food that has no nutrition and their brain does not turn off eating to tell them they're full because they're not getting the nutrition that they need. versus eating something that's more nutrient dense, your brain will say, oh, you've got what you need, you're full now. You need less of it to accomplish the same thing. Did I say that?
Yep,
pretty good?
Exactly. It creates like portion distortion. So if you're eating a food that has no nutrient value to it, you'll just keep eating. And then when you look into ultra-processed foods, those producers have chemists to create the perfect balance of fat and sugar to be like a slot machine in Vegas. Ding, 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 dopamine, ding, 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 dopamine, crash. What do you know? Body is so wise, God created us, that knows if you eat a carbohydrate, you're gonna get energy. Well, if your energy source that's waiting for consumption is another ultra-processed food with hydrogenated fats and processed sugars, or potentially even worse, artificial sweeteners, you just have to be aware that it's a roller coaster, that only you have the power to get off of. And that's by removing those spikes and dips so that your body can heal, and then you refuel it because you are what you repeatedly do. Start with just some purified water, because we're 75-80% water. The cell, do you know the brain does not know the difference between being tired, thirsty, or hungry? Your brain gets the same signal, and we're conditioned to eat, when what we actually probably need to do is sleep, and then you need to drink water to hydrate. So when you think of the clarity you get, if any of you went through fasting in any capacity or still currently, there's a clarity you get because you're not on this roller coaster of chemical sugar drops. It's amazing.
You know, every time that we go down south to Bolivia, I eat way less food and I have way more energy because the majority of the food there isn't yet genetically modified.
You were there, you can attest.
I can attest to that, but the other thing that Bolivia revealed to me in how the enemy is attacking us is there wasn't one meal that I ate by myself.
Oh, okay, yeah.
We were in community, which when you think of the attack of fast food, you're in your car by yourself eating a burger that won't biodegrade in 10 years, thinking you've just fed yourself to rush to a meeting on your phone or computer. Like, if that's not victory for Satan, I don't know what is. But you slow down. You slow down. You actually prepared the meal. And so we're fed this lie that we don't have time to prepare our food, or we don't have money to buy quality food. How many of you drive here? Drive a car. If your car takes unleaded fuel, please put your hand up. So it takes regular gas, not diesel. Nice and high. Come on, we'll do a workout. If you pulled up to the pump, keep your hand up, please. If you pulled up to the pump and diesel was one-third the price of regular fuel, would you put diesel in it?
No.
Why? Because it would break your car that you maybe have on a 4-year lease or a 10-year lifetimer. But yet, you go to the grocery store and you give them your dollars and you vote for the enemy to poison you. When you look for God-made organics, and you look at that and you can Google that list and see, you know, it doesn't have to be, it's not more expensive. It's actually not more expensive. You live in an area, you're so blessed to live in this area that there are local farmers that the way we win monopoly is by, as a community, we sow our seed into the person who is willing to not bow down to the GMO.
Yeah.
And so supply and demand, when you demand more, our food dealers will give us better quality foods. But right now, we're in this trend of going, oh, you know what? I'm going to go across the street after service. I'm going to pull up to Costco, which isn't even Canadian one. So that's two of the American of Costco and Walmart. Last time I checked, they're commodity retailers. They're not even food retailers. And we give them our food dollars to nourish us. Right? But think about that. Because you don't have to buy as much of quality because it nourishes your body properly.
So some of you don't necessarily have Melissa's background in training and haven't read or studied as she has. So as we're talking about practical steps, right, the hope is we can just take a step in this direction, you know. When we got married, my wife and I decided that we were going to become water snobs, and we bought a reverse osmosis system. And we like our water. We like our pure water without. But what happens is, over time, you take steps towards making better health, you know. More recently, Victoria, it's all your fault. I'm just being funny. Victoria introduced my wife to this wonderful app called Yuka. Okay. So Fridays is my day to go with my wife, and we try to spend time together. And sometimes I bump into you on Friday and I say hi, bye, because it's my day with my wife. I don't want to talk to you. I want to talk to my wife. But we were at a store the other day, and my wife was with her new hobby, scanning products. Because Yuka rates all the poisonous chemicals in the app, and it gives you a rating out of 100, and you want to try to get to a certain level to find a healthier product. And so she was scanning a lot of products the other day on our Friday. However, you know what she ended up doing? She eventually just said, Jesus, I know that there's a product in here that has a better health score than these. So eventually, in a couple minutes, she found the one that she wanted. And obviously, she uses toner. I do not. But she found a toner that was rated a little higher with less poison in it. But the point is, you may not be able to understand labels, which I'm going to ask Melissa to talk about in a second. But if you don't know what all those big words mean and on the ingredient list, something like that might be a good way to get started, because it will not just tell you the rating on the product you're scanning or you're about to eat, it'll recommend something that might be a little higher rated to you. And I get nothing from you. I'm just using that as a for instance that you can do as a step towards trying to improve your overall, lessen the intake of some of these things. But can you decode the code,
the secret code, the shopping code.
4822.
I suggested like us going out on a shopping adventure together, but this is, we just didn't do it. But when you're in the grocery store, all grocery stores in Canada use the same coding for their produce. So if the digit is a four-digit number, so for instance, 4288 is a grapefruit in any grocery store that you go to in Canada. Unless it's organic, and then it will be a five-digit number, and it will start with a 9. Now you know the code. So that's a great tool just to know, like, four-digit code, so that if you're looking at that list of going, how do I lessen the toxicity in the food, you look for those numbers, which is great. The other really key thing as far as making food more economically, to know that you're getting a good value for your dollar, is shop per unit price. And this was actually a fascinating thing I didn't share in the start, first service, but Loblaws went under this whole re-tagging all of their shelf talkers. This was just about a year ago, if anyone noticed, anyone else beside me noticed, the color of their tags are now just an off-white, and there's only black lettering. And they made very, 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 very small at the bottom the per unit pricing, which is basically really telling you what you're getting for your dollar. Because the sale price, where now you have to buy 10 instead of buy 2 for a lesser price, first of all, that's marketing at its finest. Why would one package of this cost more than getting 2, 4, 5, 10 packages of this. It's because you buy more, you eat more, they got you hooked. It's not better value, right? So if you were to just discern that, then you've got a little extra money in your food budget to potentially buy one or two organics this month because you haven't overconsumed a junk food or a crap food. But the per unit price will also help you navigate if you go to a bulk Costco, let's say it. If you go to Costco and you think that it's a better value, if you look at the price per unit, so if it's per 100 milliliters or whatnot, then you'll see what you're actually paying. Because sometimes shrinkflation is a term, so they'll first give you a package with, say, 300 grams of something in it. They'll change the front of the packaging a little bit, and they'll put 280 grams in it, but they're charging you the same price. Because they already have you in the habit of buying it. So it's like, we're like, ding, eat food. So you just go and you pick up your regular, or if you order your groceries online and let a stranger deliver it to you, right? They're not gonna check whether or not shrinkflation has hit that product or not. So it's up to us to take that responsibility to actually make it a Friday date day, gang. Go grocery shopping together and get the best bang for your buck.
So, Pastor Larry, if you hear this statement, it's up to God whether I live or die, and why should I worry about what I eat, and I pray for my food anyways, what is your thought on that?
Oh, my goodness. What did I say again? You know, we, in a spiritual sense, we all understand the passage where Paul's talking, because of grace, do I therefore go and sin more? And the answer is obviously no, but God's grace is sufficient. But we don't just go and sin just because we can, right? And it's kind of the same thing with food as well, is do I go and eat whatever I want to because I know that God can bless that what I eat? There's always consequences for every choice we make, whether it's food or sin. And so we have to do our part to honor the temple that God has created to function in a certain way under the specific guidelines that benefit the temple. And food is that main avenue by which we receive nourishment for the body.
Thank you. So I'm going to say this, and I need everyone to listen really carefully. Please... Don't inundate me with peanut butter cookies, please. I don't need any. But I will say this, for a treat sometimes, I like peanut butter cookies. Melissa, hands down, makes the best peanut butter cookies I have ever had in my entire life, and I'm past 50.
Wow.
But they're healthy, and they're good for you. Yeah. And they're not made with a bunch of junk. But I do like them as a treat sometimes. Melissa, you can make me peanut butter cookies anytime. However, I'm just saying, my point is sometimes when I mention things, people think, oh, okay, I mentioned I need a sleep cap and I ended up with like 15 little hats. And I'm like, my point is you can eat good food that's healthy and taste good, okay? And you can do it on the budget you have. You just have to start taking steps in that direction and allow the Holy Spirit to guide you in this. And I know we're starting to run out of time, but can you share? I just want you guys to see how some of this stuff relates. You were talking about the estrogen in the back of your hamstring.
Right. So going to the point of it's not what we eat, it's what we absorb.
Yes.
And also ties into what we use on our body. So we absorb things not just through what we eat. Our skin is the largest showing organ we have. So two things with the absorption of, they're called xenoestrogens. And what xenoestrogens are is that they mimic our natural estrogens. And cosmetics, body care products, plastics, are just laden with xenoestrogens. So in the time when I was pro bodybuilding, everything in my life was measured in the sense of workout trainings, food timings, etc. And I worked with Charles Poliquin, who did Biosignature, which is a 12-point skinfold test to reflect how your body is functioning. So whether it's your liver function or your sleep quality. And the highest fat fold was my hamstring. So right below your glute is your hamstring fold, okay? And I was very, very low body fat. But ladies, if you know what cellulite is, because I would say ladies and men, we all have it. But cellulite is just a deformed fat cell. And xenoestrogens will distort their shape. And so I thought I used clean products. I had lavender. I had Aveda. I went to that other store you guys mentioned. But I drank from Costco, the large 2-liter waters, bottles of water. I always had one of those in my car. All my Tupperwares with all my food measured out to what I should eat were in plastic Tupperwares. And so I had this guru come through, and I refused to drink out of plastic. None of our Tupperwares are plastic. They're glass or metal. And I overhauled my cosmetics. And in 8 weeks, nothing else in my life changed because it was already there. I lost 8% body fat in that skinfold area, which is directly correlated to environmental estrogens. So if you're at a point where you're getting frustrated on a health sense of like, oh, I'm eating good, I'm, you know, even going to the gym, but I've got this stubborn fat or this section here. Well, this is cortisol, so get better sleep. But on the hamstring fold, you might want to look at what do your products that you slather on your skin have, because you absorb that. And to your point, yes, deodorant's another one. To your point, the water. So when you shower in warm water, that's opening up the pores to your largest organ. So you actually absorb more chemicals through your shower time than you do through your consumption of water. So if I were to say what is really, really key is that perhaps get your water at your home tested, and it doesn't have to be a full home system, although I think that's a great investment for your entire family, but you could just start with a Brita or a fridge filter. There's many different scale entries. We used a Brita for years before I convinced my husband that this is worth the return on investment, because there's so much bleach in our city. When we got our water tested, there was twice the amount of chlorine than a pool requirement. So imagine what that does to your gut. And in an enemy attack, health is our greatest wealth. 70% of your immune system is in your gut. So what is he attacking first? The ability to fight off diseases. What is Big Pharma pairing up with big food? Is that they are attacking the ability that God has given all of us to fight dis-ease before it is labeled and identified as a disease. You are what you repeatedly do. You're so worth the investment.
Thank you. So our hope is that you understand. We've been talking about Satan's agenda in the earth against the image bearer. One of the ways that he is attacking humans right now is through the things that we put into our body, okay, that were not created by God. Okay, God created some good things that are good for us to receive, and I don't want to get into Old Testament, New Testament, dietary, permissible, not permissible. Hey, everything's permissible, not everything's beneficial.
That's right.
Okay? And there's some of you that are struggling with sickness, disease. You're struggling with energy. You're struggling with, if you were to just start taking some steps in this arena, God can reveal to you the pathway. You need to spend some time and ask him, Holy Spirit, what do I need to do? What steps can I take? How can I get better in this arena? Not just, oh God, sorry, I drank poison today. Maybe you can make my life better, make my problem go away. Well, stop drinking poison, and then you'll feel better. And you guys look at me like, well, I don't drink poison. Yeah, you'd be amazed how much poison you put in your system on a daily basis if you knew that it was poison. What?
Sorry, I'm just reflecting of a place that I used to work.
Go for it.
Oh, dear. Back in the day, I used to work at a milk manufacturing company where they actually had barrels with the skull and the crossbones on the barrels being pumped into your milk products. Yeah.
1 Corinthians 10:31. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. I don't know about you, but I want to live the fullest life. I want to live a life where I thrive to the glory of God. I want to complete the assignment on my life. I don't want to have to struggle with disease because I'm lacking discipline in some areas of my life, or because I want to live in ignorance, or because I don't want to put the time and energy and effort into making some little adjustments so that I could actually live better. Yeah. And do it for the glory of God. Let's live for the glory. Let's live our fullest life. Anyways, stand with us. We're out of time.
I'm just having a few issues here. It doesn't want to open. I got it. You gonna start or you want me to?
You go ahead.
So, Father God, you have created us in a perfect form. In the garden, you created man and you said it is perfect, and you have given guidelines and instructions for us to take care of this temple. And then Father God, even in spite of sin, you sent your son Jesus Christ to die on a cross, to allow his body to be bruised and broken, that we can experience wholeness. And Father God, we still have to do our part, but Father, for the spiritual element of our body, of our existence, of this temple, we just thank you of all the promises that are there for us. And so all I can say is thank you for dying for me, that I can be made whole. And I just ask, Lord, that you would forgive me for making choices that don't honor this temple. Cleanse me, purify me. Lord, transform my heart and my beliefs into aligning with what you want for me, that I can be the most effective servant of the Lord Jesus Christ for your honor and for your glory. In Jesus' name.
Jesus, I thank you for the cross where your blood was shed for us. We've received forgiveness of sins as Christ followers through repentance and faith. We gain eternal life. Lord, we're free from the curse. But as your word says in James, we ask you for wisdom so that we can optimize those things that you've entrusted to us, including taking care of our earth suit, the temple, in the mind. Lord, guide us, lead us, let us not fall sway to the enemy's operation here in planet Earth. It seems that Satan doesn't like the humans that you created, and he wants to destroy them. Father, you came that we would have life and more abundant life, that we would have freedom. So help us, Lord, coming in and going out, help us to represent you well. And for those, Lord, that are in the struggle right now, I thank you that you're the healer. For those that aren't sure which way to go, I thank you that you speak calm and peace to their heart and show them the next step, Lord. And for all of us, Lord, help us to honor you with our temple. Let us give you glory in all that we say and all that we do. And thank you that you bring us to good health. In Jesus' name.
Well, good morning, church. I'm Norm. This is my beautiful wife, Nadine. And I'd like to just start off by thanking, first of all, Melissa for bringing such a passionate and informative message to everyone today. I think we all enjoyed it. And to the other two people that were up here, thanks for coming out. Matthew tells us, "For as were the days of Noah, so will be the coming of the Son of Man." And as we have listened to the days of Noah for the last 3 weeks, and for the next while, we will hear of the many ways that the enemy has gone about his attack upon us. Evil and darkness surrounds us. Satan quietly works in all aspects of our lives. I think it was Pastor Larry a couple weeks ago that pointed out these attacks are often through the back door, not always apparent to us. Satan attacks us strategically around in an avoidance of our armor, but only when we're not operating in our true identity and we are believing his lies. Society not only accepts it, it integrates it. In 2 Timothy, "You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times, for people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God and disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control, and they will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends and be reckless and be puffed up with pride and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly." It sounds so ominous, no? Maybe it sounds like what we're seeing and experiencing around us today. But fear not, I read the book. You're going to love the ending. Amen? So God told Noah, a righteous man, to build his ark in great detail. And an obedient and faithful Noah followed God's words and wishes. Thank you. As Romans reminds us, that we too are made righteous through faith in Jesus. And like Noah, we are given a command from God. How many are familiar with the painting of Van Gogh called Starry Night? Just put your hand up. It's very, very well known. And at first look, the painting is just a painting and it doesn't have much intentionality or significance to it. But upon further looking at it, it is intentional. The 11 stars in direct reference to Joseph's dreams. And it shows a village at nighttime, with all the buildings illuminated, except one building, the building in the center of the entire town, which was the church. We the body, we the church, we are the ark of today. We are to be a last refuge, and we are to be a radiant, unblemished, and unified church. We should offer truth, hope, and love to this lost and dying world. And in our ark, its beams and its foundation, everything should be built and be supported upon the gospel. Its hull, it should be crafted carefully and polished and perfect as it will be made of pure love. And God's word should be the nails stained with the blood of Christ holding everything together. And its dimensions and its actual physical size shall not be defined in cubits, but only by faith and obedience of God's people, as its cargo is all about to come to him and all that believe in him, and should be built to include the harvest beyond these walls. And finally, its oxygen, breathed by all, will be forgiveness.
Amen. As I was in prayer for today, a scripture from Lamentations was put on my heart to share with all of you. Lamentations 3:22-25. The faithful love of the Lord never ends. His mercies never cease. God is faithful. His mercies begin afresh each morning. I say to myself, the Lord is my inheritance. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who depend on him, to those who search for him. The book of Lamentations was written when the Israelites were conquered by the Babylonians and the destruction of Jerusalem, Judah, and the temple. When their world and land appeared to be hopeless, they were in despair, they wrote this. They were encouraged by who he is. Be encouraged that time and time again, God has made a way for his people. And just like he did for Noah, Moses, and later, Christ himself said in John 3:17, for God did not send his son into this world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Be encouraged during these difficult times and be focused on his kingdom during this time, as this we know this place is merely fleeting. Stay focused on God's kingdom rule in our lives. Our prayer for you is that he will rule in all of our lives, in our circle of influence, with all the wisdom and the knowledge that he's given us. It is in these places that we should desire and seek Jesus to rule and be recognized and obeyed as his love and message spreads across the world. So stay focused on him, his commandments for your life, for the purpose of for his glory, and know that the battle has already been won. It is well, and be at peace.
Just a reminder, the altar is open at the end of service for prayer. I'd just like to close with something we came across this week in preparation from Alistair Begg Ministries. It goes like this. Don't just attend church. Love the church. Serve the church. Give through the church. Invite people to church. Worship Jesus with the church. Encourage the church. Participate in the church. Pray for the church. Be the church. Windsor Christian Fellowship, you have been equipped. Now go